spoken about only in whispers. A dark area that spawns the beginnings of urban legends. A place where anything can happen and usually does. During the light of day, it hides just outside of view. But when the sun goes down, spirits, creatures of the night, roam free. And things do go bump in the night. It is in every state and every country, and there is no escaping it, no matter how safe you feel behind your locked doors and latched windows. So we invite you to turn down the lights and turn up your radio while we join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis, your hosts, on a journey into the darkness on the edge of town.
Hey, good evening and welcome to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Thank you for joining us. My name is Dave Schrader. Sitting across the board from me, Mr. Tim Dennis. Good evening, Mr. Dennis.
Good evening, Mr. Schrader.
How are you, sir?
Doing good.
Good. You have a good week this week?
Yeah, not too bad.
Lots of stuff going on out in the paranormal world, man. I've been cruising through the news services, and I think we're going to have some interesting stories coming up from Adrian tonight and Bree tomorrow night. I'm excited to talk about.
Oh, yeah.
One of the things I'm going to go over, there's a list posted, and I want to cover this tomorrow night's show when we're talking national. 101 ways to know if you're being haunted. And I thought this was going to be like some redneck joke, right? You might be haunted if, but it's actually a list this lady has compiled of classic symptoms of a haunting. So we're going to go over some of those lists for people out there listening. And then,
number 76, they call that ghost tater salad.
That's right. Here's your sign. We have, another cool little news story that this might be good for parents that are dealing with children that are having nightmare issues. According to a study recently, they have found out that bad smells can actually cause people to have bad dreams. So, you know, maybe we'll delve more into the story.
Keep having bad dreams?
Yes, you're tooting yourself into bad dream territory.
The Dutch oven is causing me to have eternal nightmares?
Exactly.
Ah.
We've got an interesting show tonight, Tim.
Mm-hmm.
We, of course, are going to be talking to our international correspondent, Adrian Lee, in a few seconds. We're going to hold off the movie review till the last segment of this first hour with Nicole. She'll be on with us and share a new movie review. But then in the 10 o'clock hour, we're going to be joined by a gentleman. He's going to remain basically anonymous. We'll just refer to him as Robert on the show.
Mm-hmm.
He worked for 10 years at a certain undisclosed area in the Nevada desert. A certain area, you know, in the Nevada desert.
The Palms Casino?
No, not so much.
Oh,
it's probably like 51 miles or so from there, I would guess. I don't know. It's just an area.
You worked at the Gold Field Hotel.
51 miles from someplace. Anyway, he'll be on talking to us tonight about his experiences at this undisclosed location, sharing some of his thoughts and insights on things that he's seen, hopefully doing away with some of the misnomers that are going on out in the world about this specific area. So we'll have Robert on the show for the 10 o'clock and 11 o'clock hour. So stick with us for that. Tomorrow night, we've got another great show coming for us as well. We've got national correspondent Bree Sanders and, of course, book critic Susan Cummins will be with us.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to be joined in the second hour by Richard Felix, the historian from the television show Most Haunted.
Mm-hmm.
He has a great DVD series in England about all these haunted locations. He's going to tell us about some of the new haunted locations he's been investigating for the last year. He's also going to tell us about a cool event he has coming up for Halloween in Europe. So if you're able to go out there and join him, it's a really cool little setup. He's going to talk to us about that tomorrow night. And then in the third hour from 11 to midnight tomorrow night, Central Time, we're going to be joined by Patrick Burns from the television show Haunting Evidence on True TV.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully we're going to hear back. I think we might have John Oliver join us if he's available to talk as well. And they'll talk to us about the upcoming 4 one-hour specials that will be airing throughout the month of October. First one airs on October 4th on True TV. And then here's another bit of exciting news, Tim, for people that didn't tune in last week and don't know this. Monday, mm-hmm. September 29th,
mm-hmm.
cue the X-Files theme. Pretty good. That's sad.
Yeah.
But yes, on Monday, September 29th, I am joining the cast of Paranormal State on the newest episode of the show Paranormal State. It's called First Contact. I take the kids out of their comfort zone, out of hunting ghosts and demons, and I'm taking them out for a good old-fashioned anal probing.
Hey, all yeah. right, about time.
We take them out to Gilliland's Ranch in Trout Lake, Washington, where we've talked about it on the show quite a few times over the last 3 years. I finally got somebody to believe me and go out there, and we filmed, and I think people are going to be interested to watch that episode. It airs on Monday, September 29th at 9 p.m. Central Time. Check your local listings for A&E for more information about that, and I hope that you'll join us. Again, we do have some tickets still available for the Haunted Palmer House Halloween Party with Dave, Tim, Adrian, Nicole, Bree, Susan, the whole cast of Paranormal State, the whole cast of Darkness Radio will be out there.
Been a little change.
Except for, of course, our tech talk expert, Bill Murphy, who is going to be out teching and investigating, so he won't be able to join us. But all the rest of the crew are going to be in-house with us. We're going to miss you, Bill. Hopefully we'll have you out to another one of our live events. And he is going to be out at the Stanley event with us in November, Tim, bringing a bunch of new technology to investigate with. So hopefully we can report on that when we come back after the Stanley.
Very cool. Here, I thought you were going to say Monday, September 29th, you, Shawn Michaels, Chris Jericho, triple threat ladder match for the world championship.
You didn't let me get there. That comes on immediately following.
Well, there you go.
Yeah,
see?
Dave Schrader, Chris Jericho. We're gonna fight it out mano a mano.
Imano. It's a triple threat match. You
know, I know.
It's mano a mano, imano. I think, or something like that.
Imano. That's just too many Imanos for my taste.
Imano, parts. Imano, Imano. It's kind of like Univision.
La Infrasora. All right, we're going to get into tonight's show. We've got our international correspondent joining us, Mr. Adrian Lee, shaking his furry butt out of bed at 3:30 in the morning in London, England area. Mr. Lee, thank you for joining us on the show this evening, sir.
Hi, Dave. Hello, America. You're making the assumption there that I'm actually out of bed. I'm huddled under the duvet at the moment with a torch, so I'm hoping the batteries will last.
Yeah.
It's cold here, I'm telling you.
How cold is it?
Well, it's not as cold as Minnesota, obviously, but it's cold enough to be huddled under a duvet at the moment.
All right. I don't know. I just want to hit him with a stick for saying duvet. How about you, Tim?
What kind of
man huddles under a duvet? You huddle under, like, a quilt.
I was going to say, if he's under the covers with a torch, you better be careful. Are those sheets flammable?
I've no idea. We'll find out in about half an hour.
There you go.
Tim, torch in English
means
flashlight.
Oh.
Yes, just like fag means cigarette.
Oh!
It's true. These are little bits that I did not know. A lift means elevator. Did you know that?
Really?
Uh-huh.
This is informative and educational.
Wickedly awesome means Darkness Radio.
Nice.
These are just little tidbits I thought I'd throw your way. All right, Mr. Lee, let's talk about the weird world news and dabble in the weirdness that you found for us this week and some of the new paranormal stuff.
We've certainly got a lot of weird news this week. We're going to start in the land of Dracula this week. A Romanian man has been arrested after allegedly killed his own father following an argument over a salami. These sausage rage attacks are actually becoming more prevalent in society. Wasn't a man beaten with a bologna in California a few weeks ago? Did Bree mention that?
Yes, we had that news story where the criminals broke in, stole some stuff, and then they rubbed seasoning on one man and beat another man with a sausage. So
this is obviously becoming the weapon of choice amongst the criminal underclasses.
Well, it's kind of like, I don't know if you guys ever had over there the old Alfred Hitchcock Presents TV series.
Yes, we had that, yep.
Where the old woman beats her husband in the head and kills him with a leg of lamb, frozen leg of lamb, and then puts it in the oven and cooks it. So when the police show up, she feeds them this leg of lamb as they're trying to figure out the clues to this and why they can't find the murder weapon.
Very clever. It won't be long before banks are being held up with sausage-wielding robbers shouting, "Nobody move this sausage loaded. I'm not afraid to use it."
Everybody it's a perfect...
On the floor, the granny gets it.
Well, she might be happy about that. It was you beat them with a sausage, then eat it, and there's no proof that you ever had a weapon to begin with.
Very clever. According to police in Romania, Jorge Lucescu from Sachiva arrived home from work to find his father seemingly in bed. Jorge asked his father to hand over a piece of salami, which he was keeping under his pillow, and the 63-year-old man refused. Now, obviously, hiding a salami under your pillow is a thing to do in Romania. I'm guessing those cold, long, dark, lonely nights in Suceava can really drag.
Well, it could be the fact, too, that most salami has some garlic in it, and you are in Romania near Dracula's castle, so in the event of a vampire attack, you can make a tasty sandwich and fend off the Prince of Darkness.
I just haven't thought this through, have I?
No, see, it's all in the way you present it.
He actually strangled his father after that, and as he lay in bed, and then following the next day, the neighbors found the body, and he was arrested at work. So the Suceava sausage strangler strikes again.
Good grief. Violence by meat. I just don't like the sound of this. It starts here, and then people are going to be pounding each other with poultry.
It's a slippery slope, isn't it?
Yes, it is. All right,
we're going to be staying in Romania for our next story. This hasn't been a good week for them, actually.
Okay.
I was wondering if we could have an award for the country of the week that generates the most material for me.
Okay, let's hear it.
In Romania this week.
Okay.
A Romanian sold his mother-in-law's grave with her body in it after he found out that she had only left him a pot of jam in her will. He sold the grave to a neighbor for $800 without telling him his mother-in-law was actually buried in it. But 2 weeks later, the neighbor's father died, and he discovered the body. I mean, that must have been a shocking discovery the day they were digging that hole. I mean, it doesn't mention at all whether his mother-in-law was actually dead or alive at the time she was buried.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Claudiu Vlad, 37, from Buzău, is being prosecuted for fraud after selling the grave with Roxana Petrescu in it, and his neighbor is demanding his money back, which seems fair enough to me.
Well, you know, here's the other way to look at it is, you know, his mom was certainly single and hanging out and had nothing to do, and now he just hooked him up with this guy's dad. Can't they just, you know, leave things alone to nature?
Is this a window of opportunity to set up a dating agency for dead people?
Wow. See, now that's where we got to step in. Paranormal dating, love in the afterlife.
I'm thinking that's where we've got to step out, actually, to be honest.
All right. What do we have going next?
Well, it's nice to know that it's sex after death.
Really? When do I get to start having it during life?
You're getting very picky all of a sudden.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of the way I roll.
There was actually another grisly discovery which also baffled police in New Zealand this week. They discovered two severed fingers which were left by the side of the road in Ruakaka. Officers say they may have been cut off some time ago, but they've had no reports of a gangland-style attack in the area, and the fingers were found near an abandoned Ford Telstar car. Police are now trying to trace the car's owner, hoping that it may shed some light on the discovery. Now, you know, I'm no expert on policing or law enforcement, but as an educated observer looking in, I might suggest that perhaps they could take his fingerprints. Or at the very least, send out a wanted poster with a description looking for a man who's having trouble operating a watch, maybe.
Or found these two fingers looking for a home. What do you think? You know, that gives you a whole new perspective when you say that you were driving in your car and gave somebody the finger.
I'm just wondering what kind of home you could give two fingers to be honest.
Well, I think I got a couple of places in mind.
All right. Moving swiftly on, Sergeant Peter Stokes said it's hard to say whether or not they had been surgically removed or not. They're still looking into that at the moment. Diverting to Brazil now, with absolutely no rhyme or reason, and purely on the basis that I can, a man was arrested at a Rio airport when he was caught smuggling rare bird's eggs in his underpants. Austrian Johann Zillinger was searched by custom officials who discovered five parakeet eggs wrapped in a sock stuffed down his underpants. Some of the eggs had actually hatched. A police spokesman said he put his eggs near his testicles so they would be near nest temperature. Now, I didn't know that testicles are exactly at the temperature needed for incubation. This story gives me a warm comfort, thinking that if I ever stumble across an abandoned nest whilst out hiking on a cold autumnal morning, I can step up to the plate.
Are you my mommy? Oh, Adrian, you frighten me with these stories. We're going to take a break, though.
Coincidentally, before we take a break, Adrian, yes. I have a dozen eggs in my pants right now. So there you go.
I just thought you were happy to see me.
Well.
We'll be right back. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. We'll be back with more international news of the weird with our correspondent, Adrian Lee. Good evening. Welcome back to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show, or as we like to call it, News of the Weird and Wonderful with Mr. Adrian Lee in Hour 1 here on Saturday night. Again, for those of you that think you missed the lovely Nicole's movie review, you have not. We're holding it off to the end of this first hour, so bear with us. We'll be back with Nicole in a little bit, but we're going to continue with the strange news from around the world with Mr. Adrian Lee. Adrian, we've visited Romania. We've been to, where was our last country?
In Brazil.
Brazil? Okay, and now where are we off to?
We're going to go from the heat of Brazil to the coldness of Siberian Russia.
Okay.
There was a businessman who was convinced that he is God. He worked in a furniture store, and he's actually ordered his staff in the shop to spray his furniture with urine. The man who owns a chain of furniture stores in Novosibirsk has been sent to a mental hospital. His employees claim he asked them to mix his urine with spring water and splash it on the furniture intended for sale. Haven't you got a dog that does that, Dave?
Yes, he has a furry bladder, and we'll be happy to anoint your couch for you.
this mixture of urine and fresh spring water, I think sounds quite refreshing, to be honest. I don't know. I'm sure it's got to be healthier than some of the sodas and soft drinks out there.
Well, that's probably true.
I'm pretty sure I ordered that at a bar last night.
Yes.
Yeah, could we market it as Yellow Dew or Yellow River or something?
Yes, it is.
There could be an inexhaustible supply. Also, just...
What, do you think the label will say Puppy Power right on it?
Aw.
How would you get it in the bottle?
I don't want to even begin to think about that, Adrian.
Good aim.
Good aim, yes.
It crosses my mind late on a morning for me under the duvet with a flashlight. The man also chopped off two of his fingers with a samurai sword to prove that, as a deity, he did not feel the pain. Now, I'm thinking that perhaps the fingers that were found in New Zealand might actually be his. We could try and put him in touch with them. I'm suggesting we could start a website called Fingers Reunited, perhaps. How does that sound?
I'd go for it. Let's just, maybe we should at least try to contact this cat and let him know that there's a couple of fingers in case he wants replacement digits.
I mean, wouldn't that be a stroke of luck if the fingers you lost were actually the two that they'd found? Bearing in mind you've got a choice of 10 there.
Oh, that is true. You know, kind of a strange story that was going on there. There was, Tim, do you remember where this was happening on a beach? Left feet keep washing up on the beach in this area. But they're only finding just the left foot. Have you heard of this story?
Isn't that a movie with Gerard Depardieu?
No. My Left Foot?
Yeah.
No, that was, what's his name? Daniel Day-Lewis.
Okay.
But, yeah, there's this island where these feet keep washing up in shoes and bare feet. They keep washing up their left feet. And they thought it was so bizarre that only the left feet, and they thought it was some kind of maybe weird dumping ground. However, here's something interesting. There are, depending on where the current is, if you were to throw a pair of shoes into the water, some of these islands over on the left will get the left shoe. Some of them on the right will get the right shoe because of the curve of the instep of the shoe. The way the waves take it will actually push them in the opposite direction. So shoes can end up hundreds of miles apart. I just thought that was an interesting
coincidentally, both islands sponsored by Nike.
That's
who
right.
Knew? Who knew?
Can't they just look for a swimmer who's going around in circles?
Jeez. Yes, I suppose that's another way to figure out who's missing a foot. That's interesting. They actually, I think they tracked it to the fact that there was a plane that went down in this general area a while ago, and there were like five people aboard that have never been accounted for, and they never found wreckage. So they're thinking that these might be the body parts of those people that floated up. But I just thought that was interesting that the current, because of the curve of the instep of a foot, will actually take 1 foot one direction and 1 foot another.
Hmm.
You've got to be able to save money there. I don't know what it's like in America, but in shoe shops in Britain, they only put one shoe outside on a rack. I mean, you could just go and take the one you wanted, and you wouldn't even have to pay.
Yeah, but you also would have the trouble of not being able to run very fast if they catch you.
Again, I've just not thought it through.
Exactly, Adrian.
I've only got myself to blame.
All right, where are we off to next?
Okay, continuing on the deity and the religious theme, I've got a nice story from the Vatican. The Pope has endorsed the belief that intelligent life may exist elsewhere in the universe. An article published in the Vatican's official newspaper this month insisted that belief in the existence of extraterrestrials does not conflict with faith in God as the creator or of Christ having died for mankind's sins. The idea of intelligent aliens has long been a thorny issue for the more extreme factions of Christianity, but this article follows that SETI claimed that somewhere in the vast universe there must exist planets capable of hosting life, and numerous creatures exist on the Earth, and similarly, intelligent life created by God could exist elsewhere, it declares, and this can contradict our faith because we cannot put limits on the creativity of God. So they're suggesting that God may create aliens as well, and it would all be part of creation. So I thought there was some interesting openness coming from the Vatican this week and actually saying that they're willing to embrace the idea that aliens could exist or intelligent life, but under the banner that obviously God has created everything in the universe, and they would fall under that as well.
Well, that would only make sense, but yeah, that's kind of interesting that going forward, that the church is taking that stance because it would call into effect that it's weirdness. And what do you think then? Do you think he created them? If he created us in his likeness, who did he create the other alien races in?
This is a very thorny issue.
Exactly. See, that's where I think things could get kind of wonky. And then does that then play into the fact that we were created by our God, and the God created our universe, but necessarily not the entire universe?
Well, there's dudes to say that there's other universes outside, isn't there, than the one we're in, our galaxy.
That's what I'm saying. I'm just wondering if there's many gods creating many different universes and many different species, and each one is in the likeness of that god.
Remember to pass it on the left-hand side, boy.
No doubt, I'm getting I'm getting stoner logic now. All right. Where else are we going to, Adrian?
Well, so just to touch on something I spoke about last week, actually, I discussed the story about Robbie Williams splitting up with his long-term girlfriend of 14 months on the basis that he was too busy spending nights on the internet and staring up at the skies looking for UFOs and intelligent life. She actually left him.
Right.
I actually found a story that puts a bit more depth into that. Robbie Williams actually experienced an encounter with an alien shortly after writing a song about aliens and UFOs. Robbie has become a bit of a recluse in recent years, as I said, chasing a lifelong interest in the paranormal by searching out aliens from the observatories in the Arizona desert. But the star's hunt for extraterrestrials was given a boost when he encountered a weird being. Robbie told how a weird black light flew into his recording studio in Los Angeles and out the other side again as him and his pals actually watched on stunned. He says that I had just finished writing a song called Arizona, which is about alien abduction, when there was this huge glow, and he said it was magic. Having said that, only this week, of course, Robbie Williams was actually seen walking down a high street in Los Angeles wearing a gorilla suit, so I might suggest that maybe he's having one or two issues at the present. But, yeah, I thought that was an interesting story. That was the catalyst that got him into looking at aliens and UFOs, and obviously in the long term meant that he split up with his girlfriend.
Well, I mentioned, too, you know, when we were out at the ranch filming the episode of Paranormal State, Robbie Williams was there a few days before us with the Above Top Secret group. And for you out there, guys, Google Above Top Secret. And it might even be AboveTopSecret.com is the website, but you can check it out. And they actually have an interview and I think some video footage of their excursion. And I know the one guy that hung out there with us and stayed for the episode, and actually I think he'll be a part of the Paranormal State episode as well. He was talking about how weird and how much amazing evidence they were able to gather doing the investigation there and how Robbie Williams was affected by it. So there is that information. So check it out at AboveTopSecret.com. And see, I think there is some video footage about Robbie Williams' experiments out at the ranch. And tomorrow, or on, I'm sorry, on Monday night on the 29th, you can check out A&E, the television show Paranormal State. I'm guest on that show. And we're going to be out there talking about the weird news of the world and seeing the UFOs that are out there for us. Adrian, we've got to take another quick break here. Stick with us. Everybody out there, if you're listening to the show, thanks for being here with us. And stick with us. We have more coming up. Right after we get done with a quick break. Welcome back to the show. I'm your host, Dave Schrader, on Darkness Radio. Along with me, Mr. Tim Dennis. We're exploring the world of the weird, paranormal experiences from around the world, and our international correspondent, Adrian Lee. He's here with us every Saturday night. You can listen to us in the first hour from 9 to 10 p.m., where we do the news of the world. And also a movie review coming up in a little bit here with our movie critic, Nicole Remini. Adrian, where are we off to next in the world, my friend?
Well, I'm keeping on the theme of the Vatican. The Pope's been very busy this week. He's actually instructed Vatican officials to adopt stricter criteria for the approval of visions of Mary. Pope Benedict actually asked the Spanish Jesuits to draw up new guidelines for bishops around the world on the recognition of reported apparitions. The Vatican said it had asked to launch this investigation because the Pope wanted to avoid excesses and abuses of such visions. Guidelines for the approval of apparitions and revelations were last issued in 1978. They lay down that the bishop can either on his own initiative or at the request of the faithful choose to investigate an alleged apparition. He then submits a report to the Vatican for approval. So obviously they're looking to put some stricter guidelines in place for all these visions you get of Jesus and Mary on toast and on tree trunks and, you know, in cups of tea and the like.
So now they're starting to try to regulate how we view the Virgin Mary and Jesus images? It has to go through certain protocol now?
Yeah, I think there were some stricter regulations that it doesn't become... I mean, obviously, the place that has this revelation then becomes a place of pilgrimage, and I think they were worried that it was kind of belittling the Virgin Mary appearing if suddenly she was being sold on eBay because she appeared in a jar of jam or on a pizza topping or something.
Well, but here's the point. Maybe she did that on purpose to make herself known so that she could help restore faith to America and to the world.
Well, if he was looking to access the common man, obviously on a pizza would be the ideal place to appear, wouldn't it?
Yeah, either that or on a bathroom stall in a bar somewhere. What do you think, Jim?
Now,
is that just getting into the wrong
she's
territory?
She's a virgin. She's that not giving true. Out her phone number.
You are correct.
It's strange that you should mention that, actually. I did read an article this week saying that a weight loss clinic in Ontario for women. They've actually seen the face of Jesus appear on the foam ceiling tiles in the gym area. A brown stain has appeared after a heavy thunderstorm and shows the face and features of Jesus looking down on them. And apparently it's encouraged the women to actually be more honest on their weight loss program and has apparently reduced the amount of swearing that's taking place. So I don't believe the Pope has necessarily classified this particular one, and I don't think that a pilgrimage to a weight loss center in Canada is on the cards in the near future.
Tim, yes?
Adrian, let me tell you, I've been on quite a few diets in my day and been forced to exercise heavily, and I'll tell you, I think I've seen God a few times from lack of food.
Maybe that's it, guys. We have to come out with our new line of T-shirts and little rubber wristbands. WWJE, what would Jesus eat? What do you think? The new weight loss regime.
The wine and wafer diet?
That's right. Wine, loaves, and fishes. I just think it's something to consider, guys.
Well, I mean, Jesus was a big, fit guy. I mean, he was a carpenter at the end of the day. He would have been a big lad, wouldn't he, I suspect?
I'm not sure. All of the photographs I've seen of him, he also looks like an Anglo-Saxon white American.
Ah, there is a reason for that, actually. There was an artist that drew up a treaty in the 14th, 15th century called Vasari, and he wanted whoever was going into church to recognize Jesus instantly, because they were worried that throughout Italy he was looking different in every church and every fresco. So they did actually draw up a treaty that was posted to every artist in Italy during the Renaissance to say that they had to follow certain guidelines as to what he actually looked like. So that the semiotics of that in our culture it does actually come from art history back in the Renaissance period.
Wow, interesting. You think they still would have gone for some realism and gone with, I don't know, what people look like in Israel or Jerusalem, not so much what they look like at a Grateful Dead concert. Could be wrong.
In cultures, though, if you go to Africa, Jesus is depicted as being black. And if you go to Scandinavia, he has the classic blonde hair and blue eyes. So he is seen as the kind of, you know, the ultimate aesthetic in terms of each country, of what they would consider to be good looking, I guess.
Now we know what Boy George was singing about when he was singing about Karma Chameleon, Tim.
I know.
It was Jesus' ability to adapt and change colors. So, that is so cool.
So Jesus
and his surroundings.
Yes.
Jesus in Australia is Crocodile Dundee. Did I get this right?
Said, could be. He's got the little gator skin hat on. Yeah. Could be. I don't know. That's interesting. Huh. Where are we off to next, Adrian?
Well, we're staying in Australia, so thank you for giving me the link there.
Excellent.
Marine scientists have discovered hundreds of new animal species on the reefs in Australian waters, including brilliant soft corals and teeny crustaceans, according to findings released on Thursday. The creatures were found during expeditions run by the Centres of Marine Life, which is an international effort to catalogue all life in the oceans. People have been working at these places for a long time, and there are literally hundreds and hundreds of new species that no one's ever collected before or described. And this comes as, I think, a nice surprise to you, Dave, on the basis there's still seafood and animals out there that you've not eaten yet.
Seafood. Oh.
Undiscovered food.
Yeah, that's crazy. So they found hundreds of different species?
They found 130 different soft corals that weren't previously known before. They found hundreds of different types of crabs, crustaceans, teeny shrimp-like animals with claws bigger than their body. And this 10-year census is scheduled for final publication in 2010, and it's supported by a lot of governments, and it's actually organized by the United Nations and a private conservation organization. But the thing that interests me is that, you know, if this survey goes ahead, and I think I read somewhere they know more about the surface of the moon than they know about the seabed and what's in the sea. But if they're finding this amount of new animal species at the moment, you know, it's not a huge leap of faith to think, you know, Loch Ness Monster might be there, or the Bigfoot and so on. If there's things that we don't know about...
Are you trying to tell me Loch Ness Monster is in Australia?
If you've taken a wrong turn, you will be.
Well, no, I agree with you. I mean, you know, we're so pompous to think that we've seen it all, discovered it all, but every day, every week, every month, we're exploring and finding new species of animals that, A, we thought were extinct for millions of years, and foliage, too, ferns, plants, different things like that that have popped up that we've thought extinct or never knew existed. The arrogance to me is funny that people just dismiss things like a Bigfoot and Loch Ness and Chupacabra, because there are different things popping up all the time, which is obvious here with just being off Australia's reef. And I would think that's been fished and and explored so many times already that how did we not already find this another 130 different species?
Because those guys have never run into the outdoors guys from our show, from our station here.
Oh,
that's why.
True. That's
those guys can find anything.
I mean, the benefit to mankind, of course, is that a lot of medical research is done from these animals and can, you know, further advances in the world of medicine. So that should be quite an interesting survey when that's finally published.
Very good. All right, where are we off to next?
Well, I'd like to squeeze in a ghost story, actually. I've not been to Britain this evening, so I'd like to do a ghost story.
Sure.
A millionaire businessman from Nottingham has said that ghosts have forced him to flee out of his 42-room mansion this week. Clifton Hall was bought by Anwar Rashid for £3.6 million. That's roughly about $8 million, back in 2007. But he's now handed it back to the bank. Mr. Rashid claims that during the 8 months the family lived there, they were haunted by mysterious figures and found unexplained bloodstains on the bedclothes. I think they would probably be two of the things on your list of 100 things that were meaning that you were being haunted, I suspect. He's called in paranormal investigators and he stopped paying the mortgage as a last resort. He and his wife actually moved into Clifton Hall, which dates back to the Norman Conquest, which was in 1066. And he's there with his daughters and an 18-month-year-old son. And Mr. Rashid said, "I fell for its beauty, but behind the outside and the exterior, it's actually haunted." He said paranormal experiences began on the day he moved in, ranging from tapping on the walls and unexplained voices to ghostly presences actually taking the forms of his children. Mr. Rashid added that when he found blood-red spots on his baby's quilt, that was the day that him and his wife had had enough. And they decided they'd never stay another night there. And he's had paranormal experts in, and they've been unable to solve the problem. And he's given the property back, and he's written off £3.2 million. And he said at the end, when people used to tell me about ghosts, he said he would never believe them. But now he's willing to believe anything. And he's willing to say to anyone who buys the property that, you know, it's haunted, and you're going to have to be careful because some of the experiences I've had, they've obviously been distressing for him, and he's willing to write off that amount of money to get out of the building.
Wow. Well, that I would think just in today's social environment and climate that somebody's going to be willing to pick that up for what was done before just to turn this thing into a tourist trap and a tourist attraction for people that are interested in ghost hunting.
Yeah, I mean, there's an obvious effect that dates back to 1066, that's obviously got a lot of history behind it, and it's going to be a listed building. So I'm sure there'd be a whole queue of people wanting to get into that property and look around and observe the things that are going on there.
So he said there were wrappings on the wall, doppelganger ghosts that would take on the appearance of his children?
Well, that was the thing that I found most disturbing, actually.
Right.
The ghosts were actually taking on the form of his children and then presenting themselves to him. And then the last straw came when there was blood found all over the bed sheets of his baby. It obviously appeared there and had nothing to do with the child. I mean, I wonder if there's any way that they could analyze that in some way.
I would be interested, Adrian. I don't know if this is something you could work on for us, but can you try to contact the bank system that he gave the house back to, and we'll see if we can interview somebody from the bank system if they're going to send somebody out to assess the situation, and also if there's any way to get him on the show to talk about his personal experience at this haunted house.
Yeah, I've got the name of the bank, so I can actually look that up and see if we can explore that a bit further. It's been quite a big story over here in Britain. It's been on a lot of the websites, and it's been on the news, so it's something that's been very prominent in the news this week.
Great. We'll see if you can do some follow-up for us. We're going to take another break here. We're going to be back with more with Adrian Lee, and also we'll be joined by Nicole Remini in doing a new movie review. So stay tuned. You're listening to Darkness Radio. All right, welcome back to the show. You're listening to Darkness Radio. I'm your host, Dave Schrader. Across the board from me, Tim Dennis. And across the world from us, Mr. Dennis, we are talking to our international correspondent, Mr. Adrian Lee. Adrian, we got about 5-6 minutes left here with you. Where are we going next in the world?
Well, I'd like to stay in Britain, if that's possible, and we're going to go back a bit further than 1066 in time. Archaeologists have pinpointed the construction of Stonehenge to 2300 BC, a key step to discovering how and why the mysterious edifice was built. The radiocarbon date is said to be the most accurate yet, and means that the ring's original blue stones were put up 300 years later than previously thought.
Really?
What they did is they excavated under Stonehenge. They were allowed to actually go into the original foundations of Stonehenge and actually find the original materials that they used to put the foundations up, which hasn't been done before. They actually said as well that over the next few weeks, they'll actually be able to pinpoint that date a bit more accurately. I don't know how accurately that's going to be. It won't be something like, oh, it was 2:30 on a Thursday or something. But certainly that's a new piece of information we didn't previously have. The dating is a major finding, actually, from the excavation, actually inside Stonehenge, by Professor Tim Darville and Jeff Wainwright. The duo found evidence suggesting Stonehenge was actually the centre of healing. Others have argued that the monument was a shrine to worship ancestors or a calendar to mark the solstices. For centuries, archaeologists have marvelled at the construction of Stonehenge, which lies on Salisbury Plain in Wiltshire over here in England. And mineral analysis indicates that the original circle of blue stones was actually transported to the plains from a site that was over 150 miles away in South Wales. So that in itself would have been a huge undertaking, considering how large those stones were in those days.
Yeah, no doubt.
This extraordinary feat suggested the stones were actually thought perhaps to harbour great powers. If you're going to go to all that time and effort to bring those over there, all the way from South Wales, from that distance, then obviously they would have thought at that time those stones had some kind of significance or some sort of power. They actually believe that Stonehenge was a centre of healing, a kind of Neolithic lords, if you like, to which the sick and injured travelled from far and wide to be healed by the powers of the stones. They know that an abnormal number of corpses found in tombs near Stonehenge display signs of serious physical injury and disease. An analysis of teeth recovered from graves showed that around half the corpses were from people who were not native to the Stonehenge area.
Huh.
So Stonehenge would have attracted not only people that were unwell, but also people that were capable of healing them as well.
So it was a big pilgrimage center then for people all over possibly the world to come to for healing.
That's the thought, yes. Uncovering all these corpses in the local area, there's such a high proportion of bodies found that weren't from that area, that they've almost a diaspora of people coming towards Stonehenge. And their suggestion is now that it's almost a kind of hospital that people would have gone to and been drawn to in southern England there to perhaps see if there's a way in which they could be healed.
Wow, very interesting. All right. Yeah, Stonehenge, have you ever actually been to Stonehenge living out there?
I have. Yeah, I've been a couple of times. There's a main road that goes into the West Country. So whenever you go to Devon or Cornwall, it's one of the roads that you would drive down to get there. And you can kind of see it in the distance. But the unfortunate thing is, in recent years, it's actually been roped off. So you can go and see it, and there is a visitor centre, but you can't actually go in and touch them or go in amongst them anymore because so many people were chipping bits off and graffitiing it that they've roped it off. So you can walk around it, and you can get reasonably close, but you can't actually be tactile and hands-on, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've got about 2 minutes left, so let's. I don't want to rush out of that one, but I know you had a couple more stories we wanted to cover, so what's up next?
Very briefly, on a similar theme of doing research and kind of digging in the ground, I discovered that most of the newly discovered dinosaurs are just that. They're kind of new to science, with many past fossils found, and on the basis of partial remains, there's been concern recently that a lot of double counting has actually been taking place with dinosaurs. Recent studies have even suggested this error rate might be as high as 50%, with some species being catalogued with several names. The research suggests that they're getting better at this, but since 1824 to the present day, there's been 1,047 different species of dinosaur named, and there's been an assessment made, because what happened during the Victorian period, between 1870 and 1890, there was something called the Bone Wars. And so many people were rushing to put into print new names for every kind of odd leg, bone, tooth or skull cap that came their way, that they now suspect that they've doubled up on a lot of the dinosaur names, where in actual fact they just belonged to one animal, but it was an incomplete specimen. And you were finding a thigh bone, calling that a dinosaur name and categorizing that, and then you'd find something else. And now they've discovered that if you actually put all the parts together, they probably haven't got as many dinosaurs as they actually think they've got. They did say in the report, though, that recently, in the last 20 years, it's been almost 100% accurate that when they have got a find, it's been catalogued correctly. But they're now looking back to the things that were discovered 100 years ago and actually reclassifying a lot of them because they come from the same animal.
All right, interesting. Well, we've got we've run out of time. I know you have another story that we can talk about. We'll cover that next week. So thanks again for all your help and being with us. We'll talk to you again next week, Adrian.
My pleasure as always, sir. No problem.
And Mr. Dennis, why don't you bring our lovely Nicole Remini on the line and talk to her about the new movie she's reviewing.
All right, we'll do, Dave. And on the line with us, the lovely Nicole Remini. Good evening, Nicole.
Hi, guys. I tell you, I can sit and listen to Adrian just talk and talk and talk. I have no idea what he was talking about.
Me too.
All I heard was this, like, melody of just lovely sounds.
He's dreamy, isn't he?
No, did you call me an idiot?
No, I said he's dreamy, isn't he?
Oh, I said you idiot.
No.
Hey, so this week I watched One Missed Call, which was just kind of a grizzly kind of poltergeist meets cell phone type movie. It was very interesting. A bunch of students who are friends actually get a bunch of heads up about their deaths on their cell phones. And it goes into kind of an interesting twist where there's a, I don't know, you know me and kids, I don't like seeing dead kids. And so this is one of those movies where we find out that, you know, who we're being haunted by, and we think we're being haunted by something else, and we're not. And it has kind of that Japanese flair with the fast-moving cinematography, which always freaks me out. So, you know, a good kind of creepy, grisly, like, blah, movie. But, you know, it wasn't one of my favorites because, like I said, I felt like it was kind of, you know, the 2008 Poltergeist-type movie. And it, I just didn't love it as, I've loved some of our others.
Huh. So what would you give this one on your scale?
You know what? I may give it a 3, and that's really as far as I'll go. I mean, there's a kid that I used to babysit for in California, so that was kind of cute to see him in it. So
I
have to, like, just jump to a 3 just for that alone, but he dies pretty early on. But, I mean, the calls are kind of creepy. I mean, to get a call from yourself how you're going to die is kind of creepy.
That is creepy, but it's better than spending your, or sending yourself spam, you know?
Yeah, I guess so. So, yeah, that's, I don't know. Like I say, you know, you want to, like, sit and watch a creepy movie with someone, that would be the creepy movie to watch this week.
That's true. You don't ever want to send yourself an ad saying, hey, do you need enlargement? It's not good.
Yeah, no, probably not. That'd be kind of scary.
It's bad for the self-esteem. Well, Nicole, we appreciate it. What are we reviewing next week? What are we looking forward to?
Next week I'm going to watch The Devil's Backbone, which is the same people who did The Orphanage. So another subtitle movie, and I promise to watch it and do nothing but watch the movie. So it looks, again, kind of creepy, but it's in Espanol, so you'll be able to follow along.
Muy bien.
Yes. So anyway, well, thanks for the suggestions, guys. Go to the website, darknessradio.com, and you can hit on movies and send me suggestions and emails right from there.
Sounds great. We look forward to hearing from you next week, Nicole.
All right. Have a good one, guys.
Bye. You too. Bye-bye. And be sure to stay tuned. Coming up next hour, we've got a man by the name of Robert who worked at an undisclosed area in Nevada and claims to know that we are using alien technology, that we've met aliens, have been friendly with aliens, and we've used that technology to our own advantage. Stay tuned. It's coming up next hour after the news right here on Darkness Radio.